If you have your Bibles, I want you to go ahead and turn with me to Acts chapter 27. Go ahead and turn to Acts chapter 27. Tonight I want to talk to you about a subject that I think is about as applicable as they get when it comes to God's Word and when it comes to what we're going to be talking about and what's happening in our culture right now. I think we have fallen victim to fear. I think people are making decisions. I'm talking about people I know. Maybe even some of us have made decisions that are based on fear rather than on trust. And I think a lot of it is because of those voices that are just talking to us all the time in our minds. And because of that, these fears invade our lives, they invade our hearts, and they invade our minds. And so every week, we are choosing what we're going to focus on. And if you remember last week, we focused on the fact that God says, I am. Remember that? That's what he was telling Moses. Moses was there at the burning bush. He asked God, you know, when I go and tell them that you've sent me, and they ask me, what's your name? What do I tell them? And he says, you tell them, I am, has sent you. And so at the very end of the message, and I don't know if you caught on to this or not, but what I said was, I know I am. And what I mean by that is, I know him. He is the great I am. I know I am. And that's really where we left it last week. And my question for you, as you've had a week to think about that, is yes, I can say that I know him, but can you? Can you say that you know him? Because I think once you get to the point that you can, that's going to help you deal with the insecurities. That's what we talked about last week. The insecurities that we all have to deal with. So the great I am is here to help us. This week, our focus is going to be on God says, I will. He will. Thank you. Let's straighten me out. Right? Let's straighten me out. Good. I can't see him. He can't see me. We're in good shape. So tonight we're going to talk about Acts chapter 27. And in this particular passage, we come across a guy that we've talked about before. His name is Paul. We usually refer to him as the Apostle Paul. And he's going through a storm in his life. He is in trouble. And he's trying to decide, and I think he does a very good job of it, which is why I'm so excited to get into this passage. He's trying to decide what voice he's going to listen to while he's in the storm. Are we having technical difficulties?
Mm-hmm. The sound.
Sound? Figures. We get our sound right, and now it's messed up for them. So we're going to keep going, okay? Here's what we've been learning. Go ahead and put the next slide up for me, if you would. We've learned that the voice you believe will determine the future you experience. This is now 3 weeks in a row that we've looked at this statement. The voice you believe, the voice that you listen to, the voice that you let influence you, oh yeah, it's going to determine the future that you experience and I experience. So we're going to pick this story up in the middle of Paul's problems. Acts chapter 27, verse 9, the winds are blowing, and some of your Bibles use the word contrary. Have you ever had a contrary child? You ever had a contrary friend? You ever had a contrary pastor? Oh, no. Never. Couldn't be like that. They're in a boat. The sailors are really having a hard time because of the storm. Paul is on board a ship with 275 other prisoners. So there's more than 275 people on the ship because you've got the guards, you've got the people that are running the ship, you have all kinds of hands to help. Now, if I'm Paul, I'm thinking at this point, I just can hardly believe it's true that I'm headed to prison again. He's going to stand trial before Caesar. And this is not a cruise ship. Could we identify that real quick? This is not the Royal Caribbean. All right? There's no shuffleboard up above. There's no swimming pools. There's no lunch buffet for you to go to. And he is not headed to Rome because he thought it would make a great vacation. That's not what's going on here. He is chained as a prisoner. And if that wasn't bad enough, in the middle of all this, he is facing a storm. Let's pick it up in verse 9. It says, much time had been lost. Can we go to verse 9 here? Thank you. Oh, I don't have the verses up here tonight because it's such a long passage of scripture. Forgive me for not telling you that until now. You need your Bibles out. Or you need your smartphone out. I apologize. I've just been so excited about doing communion and getting into this message. So, I'm going to give you the passages, and you're just going to have to go with me. So, Acts chapter 27, are we there? Pretty much. We're going to pick it up in verse 9, okay? Let's try this again. Much time had been lost, and sailing had already become dangerous, because by now it was after the Day of Atonement, which would have been a fall date, according to the way their seasons go. It says, so Paul warned them, and the them here are the other people on the ship. He probably is talking to anybody that would listen to him. In verse 10, he says, men, I can see that our voyage is going to be disastrous. Isn't that exciting? Yeah. We're not playing Pollyanna here, are we? Y'all know what that reference is to, Pollyanna? Some of you don't have a clue. It was a, Some of you will have to check that out later. He says, I can see that our voyage is going to be disastrous and bring great loss to ship and cargo and to our own lives as well. Verse 11. But the centurion, this would be like the head soldier guy. He's the one who's in charge of transporting the prisoners. The centurion, instead of listening to what Paul said, followed the advice of the pilot and of the owner of the ship. Let's stop right there. And can we just say, of course they ignored Paul, right? Yeah? If you've got to make a sailing decision, it makes sense, doesn't it, to listen to the pilot of the ship and to the owner of the ship and not to the preacher who just happens to be on board ship, right? Sometimes preachers think they know everything. Can you believe that? That just blows my mind. The preachers think they know everything. So Paul gives advice to them on where they should steer the ship, but they ignore him. Now later, they're going to pay for it because Paul doesn't just represent himself. He's not just a preacher on this cruise. He represents, in bodily form, the purpose and the mission and the voice of God. So when he talks about how they're going to be in trouble, he's warning them on behalf of God. And it's going to take them a little while to really come to the point where they trust him or understand him. So what I want to do tonight is I want to give you three thoughts about what to do when you find yourself in a storm. So let me give you the first one. If you're taking notes, write this down. Here's the first thought. If you find yourself in a storm, you must steer by the Spirit and not by your senses. You must steer by the Spirit and not by your senses. And as you're writing that down, let me just say this. It's a whole lot easier to steer by our senses because we want to see where we're going. We want to feel like it's the right thing to do. We're trained to live by what we see. We're trained to respond by how it feels to us. That's exactly what got the men in the ship on trouble. In trouble. Now, when we talk about fear tonight, we're not just talking about those big things that all of us are afraid of. We're even talking about those little things that we just kind of dread. Do you ever have anything that you just kind of hang on to and you can't really put a finger on it, but you know something's not right? Can you let somebody in at the back door, please? Somebody's coming in. Don't stare at him because now I thought Paul's working. I think we have a tendency to just live with all kinds of little fears. Instead of dealing with them, we just kind of carry them with us. We go through life worried. Can we be honest? Sometimes we're worried because we're afraid of what somebody else is going to think about our choices. Sometimes we're worried because we're afraid of what somebody might say about our choices, or we're worried that if we've made the wrong choice, we may fail. Now, let me throw this one at you. Sometimes we're worried that if we make the right choice, we will succeed, and people will talk about us because we succeeded. How in the world did they do that? They're not that smart. Ever anybody say that to you? I've had them say that to me.
Yeah.
You know, if we succeed, think about it. There's going to be more pressure. Because, listen, if you fail, what are they going to do? They're going to laugh at you. But if you succeed, guess what? They're going to expect you to win again. Boy, that's pressure, isn't it? So in this case, God's warning through the Apostle Paul has been ignored. When you and I ignore God's warnings, we will suffer. I was going to ask for a show of hands on this, but I'm not going to do that because I think everybody's hands would go up. But I wonder how many of us are willing to admit, I've ignored some warnings from God in the past, and I have paid the price for that. I think a lot of us have gone down that road. I point that out to us because somebody or something is steering your life, okay? And are you being steered like these men on the ship are by what they see? Because I guarantee you they had their maps out, they had all of their instruments out, and they knew how to sail, and they thought they knew exactly where they were going. But what have we already said? As followers of Christ, we walk by faith and not by sight. And if you steer your entire life by your senses or by what feels right to you, you're going to end up in trouble. Now, can I just tell you, I do not like standing in long lines outside on warm days. So I'm really struggling with the fact that probably in a couple of months here, I'm going to have to go get a license renewal. And you know, that's what I've seen. I drive by and I see all these people out there. And my gut reaction to that is, Alita, you go. And she thanks me. And you know, I will be buying her supper for the next month after we get that done. I just really don't like to do those things. Now, if she wasn't there to help me, and I just really didn't want to do it, and I kept putting it off and putting it off and putting it off, what's going to happen at some point? I'm going to get in trouble. Yeah, we'll just say it that way. But we have to walk by faith and not by sight. And if you steer your life by your senses, one way or another, you're going to end up in trouble. Let's get this a little more personal. If you send messages, emails, whatever you want to call it, based on how you feel in the moment, is there a possibility that you could end up in trouble? Could I just recommend that you save the message or that you save the text and then see tomorrow if you still feel the same way and then you can send it? Let's be honest, our feelings cannot forecast the future. Only the Spirit of God can do that. So we've got to learn to steer by the Spirit. Honestly, wouldn't that save us a lot of time and trouble if we would stop trying to steer it all ourselves and start listening to what God had to say? Let's put this statement up one more time. I love this. The voice that you respond to will determine the future you experience. And that's so true in even the little bitty everyday choices that we make right now. We got big choices to make, and we have 100 little choices to make. Are you steering by your senses, or are you steering by the Spirit? So let's pick back up with the text. Let's go to verses 14 and 15 next. It says, before very long, a wind of hurricane force called the Northeaster swept down from the island. Verse 15, the ship was caught by the storm and could not head into the wind, so we gave way to it and were driven along. If you highlight or underline in your Bibles, highlight that, those two words, driven along. The ship was driven along because it couldn't do anything else, right? At least that's how they felt. I think this is a great description of the way some of us live our lives. When a thought of panic comes to us, sometimes we just give into it. I don't know how to fight. I don't know what to do. I'm just going to give into that panic. Sometimes we get so nervous that when that nervousness starts coming out upon us, we just kind of go with it. Somebody says something, and we know it's not the right thing to do. We know it's not the right direction to go in, but we don't want to rock the boat, so what do? We're just driven along like everybody else. And where does this take us? Well, if you're anything like me, sometimes this plays itself out in what I call the worst-case scenario mindset. My mind starts taking me down these roads of what is the worst possible thing that could happen. And when you get to that point and you are being driven along like this, you can't function correctly. You can't even give yourself fully to the people that you love because now you're worried about losing them if you make the wrong choice, and you can't even interact with them because it's all going to get so messy. You're being driven along by a spirit of fear. Meaning you don't have an anchor in anything. You're just being driven along and you're always worrying about what's going to happen next. Hear me very carefully. There is a very fine line today between precaution and paranoia. You don't know how bad I want to hop off right here and go down that road. Because I believe as a nation, we are living in paranoia. We are living with fears that we don't need to live by because we've got God to guide us. We're being driven about by winds that are contrary. And I think it's time to come back to God and trust God. Either we trust Him or we don't. Okay, I need to get back to this sermon. I'm going to get in trouble. Verse 16. As we passed to the lee of a small island called Cauda, we were hardly able to make the lifeboat secure. So everything is unstable at this point. Nothing is the way that they want it to be. Can you identify with that? Gone through those times in your life when everything just seemed off? Even the normal things that you do, just, they're not right. Verse 17. So the men hoisted it aboard. They brought the lifeboat aboard. Now this next part, I've always tried to imagine it. It says, then they passed ropes under the ship itself to hold it together. Think about that. You've got to start, you've got to get the rope over the smallest part, and then you've got to kind of work it under. You're going to keep walking back, and you're working this rope, would have been a good size rope, all the way under your ship. And you're not just going to do it once. You're going to do it again and again. I don't know how many ropes they had, but basically what it is they get those ropes, and you finally get to the end of them, and you tie them off in hopes that you can hold your ship together. Wow. Because they were afraid they would run aground on the sandbars of Sirtis, they lowered the sea anchor, and here it comes again, and let the ship be what? Driven along. They just let it go. They were saying, you know what, guys? We put the rope around the boat. Now the situation is beyond our control. I don't think we ever reach that point. I honestly don't think we ever reach that point. I hope we don't, because God is there to help us. And even though we may feel like the whole thing is about to fall apart, I believe God is there. And I believe we've got to trust God more. Verse 18, we took such a violent battering from the storm that the next day they began to throw the cargo overboard. I have no idea what the cargo was, but you can kind of get, this was not a small boat, right? 275 prisoners. We know there was cargo of some kind. I'm just going to assume that they were boxes of Krispy Kreme donuts, all in a crate, you know, giant crates of Krispy Kreme donuts. Would you have rather had oranges? You know, I don't know, something. Would that make you feel better? Okay, giant crates of oranges. And so now they start bringing this up, and they start throwing it overboard. And, you know, they're just letting it all go because they're trying to lighten the ship. They're trying to do what they can to save the boat. Verse 19, it's getting bad. On the third day, they threw the ship's tackle overboard with their own hands. This would have been all the equipment they used to run that ship. All the extra ropes, all the extra anchors, all the winches and everything else that they needed. It's all going. And then verse 20 to me is a very telling verse in describing fear's ultimate goal. If we let fear go unchecked and we let it drive us along, it will eventually come to this. Look at what Luke writes in verse 20. When neither sun nor moon appeared for many days, And the storm continued raging. Just kind of get this picture in your mind, because we're headed towards something here. The storm, at first, they thought maybe they could handle it. Now the storm is just continuing, and they can't do anything about it, and they're anxious, but now they're giving up on everything, and it's gotten so bad that they can't see any signs now. They can't see the stars. They don't know what they're going to be guided by. And then it gets to that point. Look what it says next. We finally gave up all hope of being saved. I'm not even sure they had to put those last three words there. Because really what it comes down to is we finally gave up all hope. We gave up hope. What they've done here is they've gone from despair to depression. The clinical definition of depression, if you study people who are truly depressed, and there's so many different levels and types of depression these days, but let's kind of get to the rock bottom of this. The definition of this is these are people who have given up hope that they will ever feel different than they do right now. They literally do not believe that it could ever get any better. They believe it could get worse, but they don't believe it could get any better. They've given up hope that life will ever be any different than it is right now. Luke says that's how bad it was. He said, we couldn't see anything. Our hope was gone. We gave up all hope. And I don't know if I'm talking to anybody else besides me tonight, but God knows who you are. We went through that last week with Moses. He knew what Moses' issues were. Sometimes you and I become hopeless. We're not sure that we're ever going to be able to move past what this fear is bringing about inside of us. We don't think it's ever going to change the situation that it's in. See, it was one thing when you could see the stars, okay? You had a little bit of hope, you could steer by the stars, but you're in a storm and you have no star, and now you've lost your hope. He says, we finally gave up all hope of being saved. Now, Luke is the one who is writing this down. So Luke is on boardship with the Apostle Paul. Sometimes when you had a prisoner like Paul who had a little bit of clout, they would allow a traveling partner to go with you. So Luke is his partner here. But let's remember that Paul is still the main character, right? So I've got to imagine that if Paul was reading what Luke was writing, and Luke just wrote, we gave up all hope of being saved, I think Paul would say, whoa, wait a minute, time out. Who's this we? I really don't think Paul gave up. Everybody else had given up hope. Everybody else had given into fear. They are, in our words, freaking out. And then Paul speaks up, and you're going to love this. These are such encouraging words. Verse 21. And after they had gone a long time without food, Paul stood up before them and said, men, you should have taken my advice. Wow. I think some of you ladies just found your life verse. Man, you should have taken my advice. And that's just a nice way of saying, I told you so. You guys don't ever do that, right? Never. God strike you if you lie into me. No, I'm just kidding. He says, you should have taken my advice not to sail from Crete. Then you would have spared yourself this damage and loss. And then look at the first two words of verse 22. But now. Stop right there. But. I love those two words. But now. It's one thing to believe that God will get you out of a storm if he's the one who put you into the storm. But don't a lot of our fears come from believing that, you know what? I got myself into this mess, and I really can't depend on God to get me out of it. I'm going to have to get myself out of it. You know, I know Daniel, God allowed Daniel to be thrown into the lion's den, so you know God's going to help him get out of there. But, you know, what if it's my fault? I think that's where real fear kicks in. Is if we believe that, you know, hey, I'm the guilty party here, and I don't really think God owes me anything. He doesn't have to deliver me. He doesn't have to bring me out of this. You understand what I'm saying? You know, what if I lost my job because I was lazy? You don't have to tell anybody else about that, you know. You can stick to your story about how the boss didn't like you, but what if you know deep down that you could have done a little bit more to help you keep your job? So now you're unemployed, and you know that you're at least a part of the cause for why you lost your job. Is God still going to help you? Will he still be there for you? Let's go in another direction. What if it's your marriage? What if your marriage is on the ropes because you, yes, you, were not as loving and not as tender as you could have been? What if you, yes, you, were a little neglectful? See, it's not just in the predicaments that God gets me into that I'm worried about, because I think he'll get me out of those, but there's some stuff I get myself into. And then I'm afraid, you know what? I guess since I got myself into this mess, I'm going to have to get myself out of it. You would be surprised how much of our fear is really based on regret. Something that I did or didn't do is now catching up with me. So now I'm out here on my own. If you've ever been fired from a job, can I just tell you that this is the one thing that will just eat you alive? You will play scenarios over in your head. What could I have done differently? What should I have done different? Sometimes you will stay awake all night because that little voice just keeps going around and around and around. But Paul says, but now. Now let's focus on that last, that second word, now. If I had time, I'm going to do this sometime. I'm going to do an entire sermon on the word now. Because I love this. In the book of Hebrews, it says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. So when you can't see the stars and you've lost all hope, Paul says, but now. Yes, there are some things you and I could have done differently. Yes, there are contributions we made to this particular mess, but now, even though I can't change what I did, even though it should have been different, I can't complete what I left unfinished. Things are the way they are, okay? But now, verse 22, but now I urge you to keep up your courage. And that's our second point. Let's go ahead and put that up here. Fix your focus and keep up your courage. So I was going to give you three statements. That's the second of the three. Fix your focus and keep up your courage. And after you've written that down, just turn to somebody beside you and tell them, keep it up. Keep it up. Come on. Keep it up. Tom, keep it up. Judy, keep it up. Yeah, keep it up. All right. Paul goes on to say, the rest of verse 22, keep up your courage, because not one of you will be lost. Only the ship will be destroyed. So it's like, okay, everybody, we got good news and we got bad news, all right? Now, bad news about the boat not looking so good, all right? But keep up your courage because we're going to make it. How do I know that? God told me. That's literally how it would have come across to those people. God told me, except for the fact that maybe, since Paul had already done that at one, I told you so. Let's go to verse 23. He's got quite a story here. Last night, an angel of the God whose what? I am. Oh my goodness, can we tie this back to what God said to Moses last week? I know I am. An angel of the God whose I am, see, Paul knows that he knows I am, and he knows whose he is, whom I serve, stood beside me. And I love the fact that it says it stood beside him, because it means that God stands by me in the midst of my trouble. He doesn't always go before me. He's not always behind me, but he is always right beside me. And he said, verse 24, do not be afraid, Paul. You must stand trial before Caesar. And God has graciously given you the lives of all who sail with you. I love that. Please hang on to that verse. Hang on to what just got said, because it's going to come back into play later in the story, because you're not going to realize it unless I get you thinking about it now. Okay? What did God tell him? He said, you are going to go stand trial before Caesar. In other words, there's not going to be anything that happens that's going to keep you from making it all the way to Rome. Oh, and by the way, everybody that's traveling with you, they're all going to be okay, because I said so. So he's saying, listen, I'm not focused on the storm. I'm focused on the future that God has promised me. Verse 25. So Paul says, keep up your courage, men. I have faith in God. And then here's my favorite line in the sermon. That it will happen. I like that. That's really the title that I use for my message. It will happen. He says, I have faith in God that it will happen just as he told me. Verse 26, nevertheless, I've never liked that word. Have you? Do you use that in common conversation? Nevertheless. Look through yonder window, cometh Bruce Wolfeth. But nevertheless, I'm sorry, it just happened to me. Yeah. Nevertheless, verse 26, we must run aground on some island. So what's he saying again? Hey, the ship is going down. But keep up your courage. Question, how do you keep up your courage when the ship is going down? Listen, this is at the heart of faith. You have to learn to separate your courage from your conditions. Oh, this is good. This is for somebody here tonight, because if you can do this, it is going to save you so much. If your courage is tied to your conditions, when your bank account goes down, your courage will go down too. If your courage is tied to your conditions, when a certain relationship in your life starts to go down, guess what? Your courage will go down with it. How do you keep up your courage? Well, I'm going to just make a statement here, and I'm going to double dog dare you to prove me wrong. Apparently, even when our conditions are outside of our control, our courage is never outside of our control. Even when my conditions all around me, out of my control, apparently, based on what's going on here, God says that your courage is never outside of your control. Our courage is under our control. Keep it up, he said. Keep it up. Feed it. We have been feeding our fears. Stop watching the news. I dare you to go 1 week and not watch any television news. You will feel like a new person. I know, because I did it. It's incredible. It is just incredible. So many things I want to say. You know, there's so many times we can't fix the situation that we're in. The only thing that I know we can do at this point is to fix our focus. Paul says, I know right now all you can see is the ship going down, and I know that that's all you're thinking about. But he said, last night I had an angel talk to me, and I'm not looking at what we're going through. I'm looking toward my future, and I'm looking at what God is going to do, because he told me that I'm going to make it all the way there. So that's where Paul's focus was fixed. We want God to stop the storm, don't we? We want God to stop the virus. Have you prayed that? I've prayed that. God, just make it go away. Wouldn't that be so great to wake up tomorrow morning and the coronavirus would just be, poof, gone? I have no guarantee that God's going to answer that prayer the way I want him to. Sometimes what he wants to teach us is that the greatest thing we can do is learn how to fix our focus in the middle of the storm. We don't need to stop the storm for us to get our courage up. We don't need God to fix the ship in order for us to get our courage up. We don't need God to take the virus away in order to get our courage up. We need to fix our eyes on Jesus, who is the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising its shame. I'm trying to help some of us tonight see that our hope is not supposed to be in the boat. The reason the sailors were scared is because they were trusting in the boat to get them to where they were going. But Paul says, you know, funny thing about this boat, I kind of like it. I prefer it over doggy paddling. I could just see that, but I had a meeting with God, And if there's one thing I know about God, it's that my life is in his hands, and I know that he's going to take care of me. My hope is not in my circumstances. My hope is not in this boat. My hope is in God. And if the boat goes down, my faith is still in God. Fear's greatest hit. It's only had one. We call those one-hit wonders, right? What's your favorite one-hit wonder? I'm just curious. What's your favorite one-hit wonder? Fill Me Up, Buttercup? Was that a one-hit wonder?
I don't know.
99 what? 99 bloom? 99 balloons. I didn't hear that. Oh, Andy Grable, he had more than that. He had more than one hit. You guys have missed the best one. The greatest one-hit wonder of all time. It's a band called Looking Glass. Brandy, you're a fine girl.
Oh,
what a good wife you would be. But you're... Yeah. Brandy, you know, it was even in Guardians of the Galaxy 2. It was like the big song. Yeah. I'm sorry. You should know. Fear's greatest hit, its only hit, is the song, What If? What If? And that's the song it's going to keep playing. It's going to lead us, what if will lead us down wrong paths. It'll lead us into all kinds of problems and lead us through all kinds of predicaments. But hear me, even if the worst possible thing that you can imagine comes true, won't God still see you through it? This is where fear either takes over your life, or we push back against the fear and realize that even if the worst case scenario plays out, God is still going to be there. There's an awful lot of people who think that fear is really all about denial. Oh, it's never going to happen. Never going to happen. If I just keep believing, it's never going to happen. It'll never happen, right? It'll never happen. Tell the person next to you it's never going to happen. Tell them, come on. Tell them, if I believe hard enough, it's never going to happen. It's never going to happen, right? Because if I believe that it's never going to happen, it's never going to happen. Not going to happen to me. Not going to happen to you. I don't know when it's going to happen, but it's not going to happen to either one of us. Amen? I thought that was pretty loud. All right, I know. You weren't going with me there. Now, I do think it's important that we don't walk around playing out the worst possible scenarios in our heads. Because most of the things we worry about are never going to happen anyway. Worry, I've heard this so many times, worry is a down payment on a problem you may never have. Most of the things that will be the biggest challenges in our lives will be the result of things that never crossed your mind. They will blindside you at 4:30 on a Thursday afternoon. You won't even know that you needed to worry about that until it's right there in front of you. Additionally, most of the things that we worry about actually create other problems that we didn't even know to worry about when we started worrying about the things that we were never supposed to worry about in the first place. Don't try writing that down. Can I just give it to you a real easy one? Worry has babies. Worry has babies, right? Worry creates all kinds of conflict that we were never going to have to face if we had just turned it over to God in the first place. Far from solving our problems, worry exponentially increases them. And every once in a while, you know what would be kind of fun to do? It would be kind of fun to stare the devil in the face and say, okay, devil, what if it does happen? God's still going to be there with you. What if it does happen? What if all this junk that you're putting in my mind actually happens? You know what? God is still going to be there. Because sometimes the worst thing does happen, doesn't it? I know that's not the churchiest answer, but sometimes it does. Even if you and I fall all the way to the bottom, God will still be there. My Bible tells me God is the God of the valley, too. Paul said we might have to swim to the island, but we're not dying out here. So we're still in verse 22. The last part of it, he says, only the ship will be destroyed. Was that exciting for you to hear if you were on board? Only the ship is going to be destroyed? It depends on how you read the verse. If all you read was the ship will be destroyed, that's bad. But back up one word. Only the ship will be destroyed. What does that imply? The ship's going down, but boys, we're not. There's only one word that stands between fear and faith. I'm not counting on this boat to get me to the other side. My hope is not in the boat. My faith is not in the church. I love this church, but my faith is in God, who said, upon this rock, I will build my church. I'm not counting on the boat to get me to the other side. I'm counting on the one who made the wind and the waves. I'm counting on the one who made the tree that this boat was built from. I'm counting on him. And wouldn't you know it, everything happened just like Paul said. Let's go to verse 41. But the ship struck a sandbar and ran aground. The bow stuck fast and would not move. And the stern was broken to pieces by the pounding of the surf. It's just kind of hard to imagine that the water is coming in so hard and so fast, and it's just starting to take pieces away with it. It's starting to take those timbers away. The pounding keeps coming, but that's not what Paul is focused on. He's focused on his purpose. He's focused on God's purpose. Look what it says in verse 42. And I felt sorry for Paul when I read this. The soldiers planned to kill the prisoners. Ooh, Paul was one of them, right? To prevent any of them from swimming away and escaping. So it's kind of like you look at Paul and said, hey, thanks, you saved our lives, but now we're going to kill you. How many of you know that when the enemy plans to take you out, God always has a plan to keep you in? Whenever the enemy has a plan to take you out, God has a better plan to keep you in. Verse 43. But the centurion wanted to spare Paul's life and kept them. If you highlight words, highlight that word kept. Kept them. Do you know how many things God has already kept from happening in your lives and you and I have no clue? How many times has he stepped in? How many times has he intervened that we don't even know about? We know about some of them. But how many times have we been in danger, but God was in the way? Are you telling me, once you understand that you still can't trust God? He kept them from carrying out their plan. He ordered those who could swim to jump overboard first and get to land, verse 44. The rest were to get there on planks or on other pieces of the ship. You're going to make it, but it might not be the way that you imagine. Look at the next line. I love studying the Bible. In this way, everyone reached land safely. What does the word everyone mean? Everybody, all of them, they all made it. It wasn't the way they wanted to. I'm sure it wasn't the most comfortable way or the most convenient way, but my faith is not in how it will happen. My faith is in the one who will see that it happens. You might have to hold on to a board, a timber, and float your way in. But we're going to make it. Don't let your faith come down because you don't understand the circumstances. But these people got to shore, and we can make it in faith if our faith is not in the boat. We can make it if our faith is in the right place. Okay, we got one more thing to cover here. And Paul makes it through the shipwreck, survives the storm. Now we get to chapter 28. And I don't know about you, but I am expecting a victory party on the beach, right? Talk about prime commercial real estate. You know, you bring the television cameras out here, we're going to shoot this, you guys all coming up on the shore and giving each other high fives and woohoo, we made it. You know, I don't know what you're going to sell here, but you can just use your imagination. Everybody's on the beach, great backdrop for a commercial. You know, you think you might want to party a little bit. Verse 1, once safely on shore. Do you guys have an imagination? Because sometimes when I go off on things like that, you're looking back at me like, what is wrong with him? Nothing. There's nothing wrong with him. Once safely on shore, we found out that the island was called Malta. And I can't help it. I think of malted milk balls. Does your mind like go in those directions? My wife loves malted milk balls, by the way. If you ever don't know what to get her a package of malted milk balls. She loves those. Verse 2, the islanders showed us unusual kindness. Isn't that interesting? That oftentimes when we get where God wanted us to be, he'll have people there to take care of us. Oh, yeah. So don't worry about the people who lead you on the way. God's going to always provide somebody in the future to help you accomplish what he's given you to do. They built a fire and welcomed us all because it was raining and cold, so we got a fire going. Can you picture this? We're roasting marshmallows, we're making s'mores, they've already got hot chocolate going, and so they start pouring the cups. Got it? Got that picture? All right. Verse 3, Paul gathered a pile of brushwood, and as he put it on the fire, a viper, driven out by the heat, fastened itself on his end. We're not just talking a little glancing glow. We're not just talking about a little bitey-bitey, you know? The viper fastened on to his hand. Can we just thank poor Paul? I mean, as if he's not had enough to go through. He's going to trial. He's a prisoner. He's been through a shipwreck. And now here comes the snake. He's trying to build a fire. He's trying to be helpful to everybody. And all it did was it drove out the snake. And I want to point this out to you. Whenever you light a fire, you really ought to expect that some snakes are going to come out. You know what I'm talking about? When your passion for God increases, and you start burning brightly for the things that God wants, and you start trying to serve God, don't be surprised when it brings out a snake or two. The same fire that warmed the people also drove out the snake. Verse 4. See, I've still got it. So if I start to pass out, you'll come up and you'll pull the off for me. Because nobody did that for him. Look, verse 4. When the islanders saw the snake hanging from his hand. You got this picture?
Yeah.
They said to each other, they stopped to have a committee meeting. This is ridiculous. This man must be a murderer. For though he escaped the sea, the goddess Justice has not allowed him to live. What did you notice? Ain't nobody coming up to help him. They had a committee meeting about what he's done wrong. This guy's got to be a murderer. And remember, I told you it was Luke who was traveling with him. And what do we believe Luke's profession was? A doctor. So I'm kind of anxious to see how he describes the snake bite. It's very, very simple. Verse 5. Paul shook the snake off into the fire and suffered no ill effects. Which brings us to our final point. Are you ready? In the spirit of, go ahead, help me here. In the spirit of Taylor Swift, our point is, shake it off. If I thought I could get by with trying to sing that song, I would try to sing that song right now. But we all know better, don't we? Yeah. And I don't even think you got that one in the books over there. No, don't have that. Shake it off. You and I have to learn how to shake off the snakes. Aren't you proud of Paul for not screaming? Would you? Mm-hmm. If the viper had gotten your hand, it doesn't say Paul. It says he doesn't get bit and stand there in a state of shock. I think he gets bit and looks at the snake and he goes, really? And he gets rid of it. And you know what? As I was studying this, I really was asking myself, how does he have the presence of mind to do this? Because I am not a big fan of snakes. If a snake bites me, you better be ready to pick me up. But I'm going to ask you one more time. Why? How could Paul have the presence of mind to know that that snake was not going to be the end of him? We talked about this a little bit ago. I said there was a verse you needed to remember. How did he know that the snake wasn't going to be his end? How did he know that? Okay, you're all reminded. Yes! The angel of the Lord told him, you are going to Rome. You're going to stand in front of Caesar. Listen, if God went to all that trouble to tell you that, and some little penny snake, whatever, don't you dare put a rubber one in my drawer. It's like, no, God's already said I'm going, so let's get rid of you right now. And look what he does. He throws it back into the fire. This is an incredible metaphor. This is such a picture for us. There are snakes in your life right now. You have snakes that will attack your faith. You have snakes that will attack the way you think. You have snakes that, by the way, you notice that God did not let him step on the snake's head. That's what we would like, right? Can I suggest to you this? I believe God said, Paul, I have to let this snake bite me. Why? Because I've got to prove to everybody that I can let fear bite you and even attach itself to you, that you know what to do when the snake starts biting. Shake it off. Shake off the problem. Shake off that worry. Shake off that fear. Shake that bad report. Shake that test result. Shake it off. And he shook it back into the fire that it came out of. Anytime we start pursuing God, there's going to be another voice that tries to bring us back. And we have to shake it off. I don't know what you're going to do with the fears that you are facing right now, but I really think you need to put it through some of what we've talked about tonight. I have become a student of reading newspapers right now because I've learned that what gets put on the headlines is really not usually the most important thing that I read about in the story. When they tell me, this number, this number, this number, but then I go down in the article and I read, and my wife is back there cautioning me to be careful. I read about how many people are cured and how many total people are just going to be fine. And then I look at that other number and I look at this number and I'm going, what bleeds, leads, right? You know? Are you with me? I cannot give in to fear. I'm trying to help you not give in to fear. God's got me back. And Paul is going to make it all the way to Rome. To do what? To be on trial. I think God's still got stuff for you to do, people. He's got stuff for us to do. He's got stuff for this church to do. And one of them is that this preacher better stop preaching. Because she's so upset that she's throwing her phone at me now. So stand with me and we'll have our closing prayer. I thought it was coming my way. That's all I can say. Would you bow with me, please? Father in heaven, thank you so much for this story tonight. It's incredible, the things that we've learned. We've had some fun with it, but you gave us your word so that we could learn from it. Father, help us not to be overcome by our fears. Help us to realize that no matter what we go through, you are going to be there with us. Lead us now, Father. In the name of Jesus, we pray this. Amen.